In the annals of medical history, there exists a practice that seems bizarre and downright gruesome to us today. It's a practice that spans centuries, believed to cure ailments, and even endorsed by the most esteemed physicians of its time. Imagine a time when the solution to almost any malady was believed to lie in draining the very life force that courses through our veins. It was called bloodletting, and it's a practice that defies our modern understanding of medicine. Join us on a journey back in time as we explore the strange and often horrifying history of bloodletting. From its origins in ancient civilizations to its peak during the Middle Ages, we'll uncover the beliefs, rituals, and consequences of this peculiar medical procedure. But be warned, this journey into the past will reveal a medical practice that is not for the faint of heart. So, fasten your seatbelts as we delve into the strange world where medicine met myth, and the cure could be as deadly as the disease itself. By the end of this journey, you'll have a newfound appreciation for the advancements of modern medicine. Our journey into the strange world of bloodletting begins in the ancient civilizations of Egypt, where medical practices were intertwined with mysticism and spirituality. In the scrolls of ancient papyrus, we find evidence of the earliest forms of bloodletting. The Egyptians believed that illness was often caused by evil spirits or imbalance in the body's vital forces. But it was in ancient Greece that bloodletting started to take on a more systematic approach. The renowned physician Hippocrates, often hailed as the father of modern medicine, played a pivotal role. Hippocrates believed in the theory of the four humors, where health depended on a balance between blood, phlegm, black bile, and yellow bile. To restore this balance, he advocated for the practice of bloodletting, among other treatments. This practice involved making small incisions in the body to release blood. These procedures were performed with the utmost precision and accompanied by rituals, as the act of bloodletting was seen as a sacred way to purge the body of impurities. As time passed, this practice spread across civilizations, taking on different forms and rituals. It was a medical practice rooted in ancient wisdom, a bridge between the physical and the metaphysical. Our journey through the history of bloodletting takes us to the tumultuous times of the Middle Ages, where the practice reached its zenith and took on a peculiar character. It was during this era that the practice of bloodletting became closely associated with barber surgeons. These skilled individuals not only trimmed beards and hair but also took on the task of bloodletting. What truly sets this period apart are the bloodletting charts that emerged. These intricate diagrams displayed the recommended points on the body for bloodletting, each associated with different maladies. But why was bloodletting so prevalent during these times? It was believed that imbalances in the four humors could lead to various diseases, and bloodletting was seen as a way to restore that balance. It's important to note that these practices were not carried out without reason. Medieval physicians genuinely believed they were helping their patients, guided by the medical knowledge of their time. Yet, the consequences of this widespread practice were often dire. Excessive bloodletting could weaken the patient, sometimes fatally. And the efficacy of this treatment was questionable at best. The Middle Ages left an indelible mark on the history of bloodletting, but it was a chapter that would eventually give way to new discoveries and evolving medical practices. One of the most iconic figures in American history, George Washington, found himself in the hands of a physician who prescribed bloodletting. In 1799, Washington fell ill with a throat infection. His physicians, following the medical norms of their time, believed that bloodletting could alleviate his condition. Over a 24-hour period, they removed a staggering amount of blood. Unfortunately, despite the best intentions, this excessive bloodletting likely hastened Washington's demise. His case serves as a poignant example of the risks associated with the practice. Across the Atlantic, in England, King Charles II was another notable figure who experienced the curious world of bloodletting. His physicians applied the procedure for various ailments. Although Charles II survived his encounters with bloodletting, the procedure couldn't prevent his ultimate passing. His story reflects the persistence of this practice among royalty. These examples of celebrity patients shed light on the pervasive nature of bloodletting in the past. It was not only the common folk who underwent these procedures, but also the most prominent figures of their time. The dawn of the Renaissance brought with it a renewed interest in scientific inquiry. Medical knowledge began to evolve, and with it, the skepticism surrounding bloodletting grew. By the 19th century, the decline of bloodletting was evident. Its once entrenched place in medical practice gave way to more effective treatments. But it's important to remember that this decline was not without resistance. Some physicians continued to defend bloodletting, illustrating the enduring power of tradition. And with that, we conclude our journey through the enigmatic world of bloodletting. We hope you found this exploration both intriguing and informative. If you enjoyed this journey through medical history, be sure to like, share, and subscribe for more captivating tales from the world of health and medicine. Until next time, stay curious and stay healthy.